Available to them. So welcome everybody. Thank you for this is the first presentation of this year's Classical Heritage Series. And I'm pretty excited that Wes agreed to speak to us today. Wes is a proud graduate of Brookfield Academy, I'm not sure what year, after which he then went on to study economics and philosophy at Wheaton College. He completed a two-year apprenticeship program in acting at the Warehouse Theater in Greenville, South Carolina. After that, he went on for a Master of Fine Arts in acting from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. We were thrilled to welcome him back to the Academy in 2012 to grow our theater and arts programs. Currently, he teaches theater in the upper school, and he serves as the executive director for arts for all levels at Brookfield Academy. And I know you're really going to enjoy his presentation, so let's get started. Wes?
Thank you, Linda. Thanks for your gracious introduction and for inviting me. The year that I graduated was 1997.
Okay.
I just had my birthday 3 days ago or so. So Linda, 4 days, Linda's making me tell my age. It's a unique thing to be on Zoom and see your own bald head sort of glisten in the light here in the morning. So, truthfully, I was grateful to put this presentation together because it's kind of taken me back a bit. I'm almost on 10 years being at Brookfield Academy, and to be able to reflect on the kinds of shows that we've done, the students that we've worked with, and maybe some of what we learned together was really a great thing for me. So I thank you, Linda, for this opportunity. All right, so the title of my talk today is The Arts as a Window into a Classical Education. And the idea here is that I'm gonna just share some of my unique experience working in the arts with students and what our approach is basically to teaching in a classical vein. What I'm gonna share with you today is not, some of the points that I'm gonna point out about a classical education are not authoritative, they are not an exclusive list of ideas, but they're kind of what came to mind for me when I thought about what does this really mean to teach in a classical education and especially in the arts. All right, so let me give you a little bit of a walkthrough of where we're headed. I'm gonna begin with a brief definition of a classical education. So there are people who are far more qualified than me to kind of give you the nitty gritty of that, but I thought it might be nice to have a 35,000 foot overview for us to start our conversation before I get into my own take on it. Then I'll define the possible elements of a classical education reflected in the arts. And for me, this means, okay, we have these ideas about a classical education, but what might it look and feel like for the student? And what about it might be enticing to them and bring them back to learning time and time again? And then we'll explore some of these elements from plays that we've done at Brookfield Academy, shows that we've chosen that we thought fit the idea and the mission of what we're trying to teach our students. And then a lot of times I think we focus on what the students are learning, but I thought it might be nice considering I'm speaking to a lot of parents, alum, board members, faculty and such, to share with you some ideas of things you might read. If you're at all like me during these COVID times, I've had more time to read than I have in much of my adult life. And so there were some things I thought I would share with you that might reflect this idea of exploring the classics and that you might enjoy reading yourself. So here's this idea. What is a classical education? I loved this library here, full of books and beautiful paintings above and all that detail in the ceiling, and thought there's a richness to a classical education. And so what is that? A classical education is liberal rather than practical in the original sense of that word, meaning that it begins with building habits rather than just practical skills. We think of some of the very specific and skilled professions like medicine or architecture. And it's beginning on a more basic and foundational level than that. It's recovered from the Middle Ages, the 6th century on, really, although it started even as far back as 600 BC in classical antiquity. Greek and Roman and early Christian cultures are what we're sort of talking about there. It expresses foundational beliefs about human nature. It has a lot to do with Greek philosophy. It's rooted in Judeo-Christian ethics, the Old and New Testaments being guides there. And out of that has been built a system of law. And it contains a lot of the cultural treasures of visual arts, music, and drama. And it allows us to explore the human experience and think about this idea of what does it mean to be free as a human, and what does human flourishing look like? So to get into a little bit of the technical terminology, I won't go too far on this, and you all have heard a lot about this. The classical education is in many ways defined by the trivium. So this includes the grammar of any subject area. It does relate to literacy. So it has a lot to do with language skills, vocabulary, often focused in Latin and Greek. And then the logic of the subject area, which is this idea of critical reasoning, argumentation, connections between evidence, facts, and maybe even studying the history of ideas and thoughts from the past and trying to follow those logical arguments. And then finally, building arguments on your own, which is this idea of rhetoric. This happens in writing, it happens verbally, and can contain poetry, literature, drama, etc. And then from the trivium grew the quadrivium, which was also part of the classical education. And this had to do with numeracy in many ways. So it was basic arithmetic that was being taught, which is sort of the abstract math. And then in geometry, they talked about math in space, basically, math being expressed on a plane and in space. Music was, this strikes us as kind of unusual, but music was math in time. And for anyone who studied music, you know exactly what that means. And then astronomy, which was math in space and time. So in some ways, the trivium can be thought of as these goals having to do with literacy. The quadrivium has a lot to do with numbers. And then together, they're building these foundational ways of thinking. And so what are some of the goals of a classical education? I think we could say that this idea of liberality, a wide learning of many subjects for their own sake, is a feature of it. Also, good reasoning, the ability to apprehend truth and recognize good logical arguments. From that, clarity in writing and verbal persuasion. Throughout, they don't really mention history, which I thought is interesting when I was reviewing these materials on a classical education or the trivium and quadrivium, but I think history was used throughout to illustrate a lot of what was being taught. I know in example, which I'll talk about in a moment, Shakespeare's education in the schoolhouse there in Stratford-upon-Avon harken back to all of these sort of Greek and Roman thinkers and historical events and battles to sort of illustrate particular points. And then eventually, there's this idea that you will grow as a human being, that you will grow in virtue. Today, we might say that our students might become gentlemen and gentlewomen, sort of trained in the cardinal virtues, wisdom, self-control, courage, and have a sense of justice, what is right and wrong in particular situations. We would focus in the arts on an appreciation of beauty, but I think that happens in a literature class. It could certainly happen in a math class, apprehending good logical arguments and beautiful proofs. All of that could be included in beauty. And then ultimately, I think a classical education still resonates with parents because, and resonates with us as Americans who are concerned with innovation and human freedom, because there's great flexibility in a classical education. It gives you this excellent foundation in reading, writing, reasoning, and character that are an excellent foundation for any other kind of subject or field that you might go into. All right, so let me give an example of what a classical education might look like, because I think we use it as a marketing term sometimes. Nowadays, a lot of what we talk sometimes is a way to share and draw people into what we're doing. But I think it can be good to look at an example of a classical education. There's this beautiful illustration here, this woodcut of students in a schoolhouse, much like Shakespeare's, which was the small room above a guild hall, maybe 500 feet from his house. It was open to boys of all different economic strata. You didn't necessarily have to be rich to get this classical education. It began at 6 in the morning. It ended at 6 at night. And it ran 6 days a week, 12 months a year. So it was pretty intense. There was lots of rote memorization and repetition of figures, speeches, grammatical constructions that students had to memorize and be able to repeat. This was over very long hours. And if they failed or were lazy or were slow in getting concepts, they were often beat. This was actually tested by the teachers at Cambridge when they were graduating to see if they could administer a good beating to their students. So I mention that because we can have a rosy or sort of fancy idea of a classical education, but it's important to remember for someone like Shakespeare in the old days, it would have been brutal in certain ways. Now, he learned this wealth of knowledge that he took with him and became a brilliant writer. Linda and I once were talking about this and joking. Did he become a brilliant writer because of that education or in spite of it? I'm not sure. It was probably a combination of both, I think. Right? He probably rose above some of the difficulty of that, but it also gave a great understanding and knowledge to him as a playwright eventually. But that's not maybe what we want for our own kids. I don't think we imagine corporal punishment as an essential part of a classical education. And this idea that we might only repeat, you know, these rote, do lots of rote memorization and that sort of thing. And of course, the inclusion of all the other subject matters like science, history, economics, music, all of those things, which were not included in the past. And I think we could say our human knowledge has grown since the 16th century. Those weren't included as well. So this got me thinking, we talk about a classical education, and I think this is one of the stars that we really reach to, but we have to make it our own. And what does it look like to us nowadays in a school like Brookfield Academy? So I began thinking about our approach here in theater and the arts, and I came up with 5 ideas that I think, for me, speak to what a classical education should do for a student, what it might look and feel like, and what it might provide for them. This is not an exclusive list. It is not authoritative. But it is just to give us some talking points. And for each of these points, I have a play that I'd like to share with you that we've worked on. And I'll show you some pictures and play a little music from them. So you'll get a real look and feel from an artistic perspective. My first idea is that a classical education should be foundational. That, of course, reflects the idea of the trivium and quadrivium. It's a strong foundation that many things can be built on. Then it should be arresting. It should grab a student's attention. The stories that we put in front of them should be rich stories. And I think it should be because those characters are encountering challenges, moral difficulties, and need to make choices. That leads me into the next point, is that a classical education should be moral. Sometimes I'll say moral / humane, meaning, you know, morality has to do with the rules of right and wrong, or the principles on which right behavior is placed. But the humane aspect is, once we understand human action and understand human motivation, hopefully we'll have some compassion and empathy for folks in a situation that's maybe different than ours. And then a classical education should be generative. I gave a little talk in before Shakespeare in Love, if any of you saw that show, where we talked about the source material for all of Shakespeare's plays. We like to think about how original Shakespeare was, but virtually all of his plays are based on something, a narrative from outside of his own writing, from classical examples to historical examples. And then finally, a classical education should be playful. Maybe this is in contradiction to this idea of the Shakespearean schoolhouse, but Shakespeare came out pretty playful even from that difficult education. So maybe it doesn't serve as a counterexample, but I think education should be fun. We know nowadays from human psychology that if a student is having fun in class, they want to come back. All right, so classical education is foundational. Let me show you or tell you a story from Midsummer Night's Dream. Some of you may be familiar with this play, some of you may not. It's one of Shakespeare's greatest comedies, and I think that's because it's based on a romantic triangle, right? Or romantic square, I don't know how you put it. It's basically a romance of one and a half. So the story starts out where we have a young lady who's being forced to marry a man that she doesn't want to, Demetrius, and the young lady's name is Hermia. And so she's not going to have that. And she and her young man decide to run away to the forest. And this other girl in question is Helena, who was in fact in a relationship with Demetrius before he switched his affections over to Hermia. And so Helena decides to tell Demetrius that the lovers have run away so that he'll follow them and she'll follow him. So these group of eloping lovers and then jilted lovers run into the forest together. And then meanwhile, we have this fantastical cast of fairies, basically, that inhabit the forest. We have the king of the fairies, Titania, Oberon, and his lady, Titania. And they're currently fighting over a servant boy that they both want. She won't give it up. So the king of the fairies decides that he's going to punish her. And he takes his sideman Puck basically to find a flower that has a love juice in it that he's going to put in her eyes so that when she wakes up, regardless of what creature she sees, she's going to fall in love with it, and this will be an embarrassment to her and he'll get what he wants. So then what happens next? So the lovers run into the forest. These two worlds collide. The king of the fairies and Puck see Helena, who's this jilted lover. They feel compassion on her, and they decide to put the love juice in Demetrius's eyes so he will fall in love with Helena. But unfortunately, Puck screws it up, puts it in Lysander's eyes, and we have two lovers then who fall in love with Helena rather than both of them being in love with Hermia, and lots of fights ensue. It's a very physical play. There's lots of great comedy in the center of this play. And eventually, they get to put the love juice in Titania's eyes as well. She falls in love with a actor who has been changed into a donkey human by Puck, and more hilarity ensues. Eventually, all of it gets worked out. They come out of the forest. There's a triple wedding, and of course, we see a play within the play where Bottom and all of the rest of the rude mechanicals put on a show for those at the wedding. Puck comes out and says, if you didn't like this play, well, then it was all just a dream. I mentioned the story of that to you to show you how fantastical and exciting Shakespeare's plays can be. And so let's look at a few photos from the show, and I'll just play you a little bit of music that we chose from the show to kind of give you the feel of the pictures, words, and music here. Let me see if I can turn on my audio. There we go. Enjoy this.
Since Duran Duran were in 2016 with their self-titled debut album, and they are celebrating in special ways throughout the year.
We're just going down a little thing. Yeah, and you really need to have your own guys. I'm launching a weekly show at 6:30 on your channel. Pandora is debuting a brand new morning playlist with commentary from the guys. today.
All right.
Who's your favorite?
It's fun to see some of those recent graduates there. You get a little bit of a feel for what the production was like. Lots of physical comedy, lots of fights. Those beautiful sight gags with Bottom being turned into a donkey, and a whole lot of beautiful poetry. So what does it take to put on this kind of show? Because this is sort of the end product of it that we see, but there's a lot of skill required from the actors. And so I thought I would just briefly share with you what, with this idea of a classical education being foundational, what do we have to do to get the actors to the point where they can put not just the movement and the words and the music and all that together, but make sense of the story, these words that were written 400 years ago for a modern audience. So the way we do that is really through a process of close reading. And so what does that mean when we say that? For us, it means this, basically this seven-step process. We have to read the play, we have to, and the small section that we're working on, we have to look up any unfamiliar words, we have to mark the scansion, which is the beats of iambic pentameter in the play. We notate any of the operative words, meaning the words that lift the speech or are the figure, where the image is. And then we notate the context of the speech in the play, what has happened in the moment before. And then we mark action. This is like what we intend to do, what the character intends to do vis-a-vis their scene partner in the scene. And then the person is ready to put some physicality to it and memorize. So let me just break that down. You can take a look at it here. So here's an example from the play. Puck in Act 3, Scene 2 says, "My mistress with a monster is in love, near to her close and consecrated bower, while she was in her dull and sleeping hour, a crew of patches, rude mechanicals who work for bread upon Athenian stalls, were met together to rehearse a play intended for great Theseus' nuptial day." So if you're the student looking at that small section of text, there might be things that you don't understand. So right at the outset, we ask them to identify themselves, any words that they don't know. Here's an example. Patches is not necessarily patches in your clothes, but refers to a court jester. Nuptial day means wedding. They might not know these words or use these in everyday speech. So once they know what the words mean, we move on to scansion. And this speech is entirely vanilla. There's nothing unusual about the iambic pentameter here. And that's the unstressed and stressed beats. Five of those in each line that together make a 10-beat line. "My mistress with the monster is in love." And in more challenging pieces, they might go through and find places where the iambic pentameter doesn't quite fit or is changed. And then we would learn what we're going to do with that, essentially. It's always a clue in Shakespeare's speeches when the pentameter changes that something emotional or important is going on with the character. This comes from my graduate work with David Hammond at University of North Carolina, but he taught us to basically diagram sentences to identify operative words. In a way, it's very simple. We end up focusing on those juicy action verbs and the nouns that are images that will light up in the audience's mind. But here's just an example of how they might break down the operative words. Sometimes we think of this as like Tarzan speak, meaning if you left out all of these things that have been crossed out, you would still really understand what was being talked about. Mistress, monster, love, close, consecrated bower. And then the actor learns to lift those and essentially let go of a lot of the rest of the words. It's not that they're unimportant, but there is no imagistic information in any of those crossed out sections. Then we'd go on and identify the context. In this section, Puck has just put the donkey head on Bottom at the rehearsal in the forest, and he can't wait to tell Oberon, his master, and see how he reacts. So then from that, we come up with some actions that we might try to play in different sections. This seems like a lot of actions for 8 or so lines of text, but really this is how you get really good acting, which is from moment to moment, the actor is changing the tactic of what they're trying to do based on what they see in their scene partner. So here, maybe he's trying to surprise and dazzle Oberon at the beginning. Then he's confiding in him, telling him a secret of what he did. Then he's dissing or mocking the rude mechanicals with his language here. And then finally looking to impress him and, you know, be even more in his favor. So after we do that, then the student is able to memorize. I've taken you through all this because sometimes students will have difficulty memorizing or won't like it, or it'll be hard. And I think it's important to say, no kidding, because if you really get into what you need to memorize well, it's a lot of work. But if we can break it down into steps for them, then they can really take off. So I said I would share some books with you that you might read on your own. This is one I've used with my kids. You put this on your reading list. I cannot recommend it enough. If you're interested in getting your kids loving the classics, I think you have to tell them the stories, and then you have to ask them to do a little work. But Ken Ludwig in this book really encourages you to find anything at your disposal to get kids to memorize. Give them costumes, bribe them with candy, make a game out of it. But he basically takes you through plays that really will fit for a young child's mind and gives you an approach for how to teach them to kids. How to teach your children Shakespeare. It's great. All right, the next feature that I have of a classical education is that it's arresting. It should sort of grab our attention. I think this is the feeling when a novel sticks with you, when the happenings in the novel kind of, you can't get out of your mind and are revisiting them throughout the next week or for a lifetime if it's a really great story. Maybe it's that kind of unsettling feeling we get, or maybe just the excitement from a really beautiful, epically told story. One example of that for us was a rewrite of an ancient Greek story, the Orpheus and Eurydice myth, rewritten by Sarah Rule in 2015. In a play called Eurydice. The feature of this that I'd like to point out for you is that we had a 12-foot wide and 33-foot long pool of water on stage for this show, and you couldn't ignore it. So I'll play a little music and we'll just look at a few of these photos. So in the story of Orpheus and Eurydice, she has just gotten married and she's drawn away from the wedding feast by this lord of the underworld. She falls to her death down a set of stairs and rejoins her father who has recently died in the underworld. In this retelling, Orpheus sings, uses the power of music to reach into the underworld and try to get back to her. And the main character is torn between the love for her new husband and the love for her father that he's lost. And the bridge between these two worlds is words and poetry. And it kind of asks us the question, what is the cost of memory, remembering someone that you've lost? That there's a beauty in memory, but there's also a cost to it and a pain. So really wonderful and interesting story. What I would like to use to illustrate this from our teaching is Aristotle's Poetics. So Aristotle breaks down these elements of a classical play, like what makes a really good play. And of course, in English departments, they compare this to literature or use this to analyze literature as well. But he talks about a really good plot. That plot of Orpheus and Eurydice grabs our attention right away. This idea that someone could die and then speak to us from the dead and that we might have a choice there, I think is really interesting. The characters should be highborn and they should fall. Literally in this story, she falls down a flight of stairs. But it's the idea that we will care about a highborn character and we might empathize with them making a bad choice or decision that they have to deal with. The thought are the ideas that are contained within the play. Diction is the style and sound of the language in this particular play. It's the poetry that also draws us in. Music also entices us and brings us into stories and was contained in the old Greek plays. And then spectacle, which is all of the technical elements that connect us to the play. In this particular play, it was that big pool of water because we talked about the underworld being wet. And there was a sound of dripping. And so the sound of that water moving back and forth as the actors worked really, I would say, is that offered that element of arresting, right? Gets our attention. It's something we wouldn't see every day. If you want to explore arresting classic on your own and have never read a Greek play, I recently listened to this BBC edition of Aeschylus's The Oresteia, which is the only complete trilogy we have from the Greek plays, and has a very arresting story, really simple plot in a way. Agamemnon comes back from the Trojan War, victorious, but isn't greeted with open arms by his wife. Instead, she invites him into the house and stabs him to death, which seems scary and terrible. But if you learn the backstory, it's because Agamemnon sacrificed their daughter Iphigenia in order to win the war, and she's not able to forgive him for that. So then what follows in the next two plays is a revenge by their son and his killing of the mother. And this sounds outlandish and crazy, but if you appreciate the rule of law, this was the first homicide court in Western culture, right? And the point being made by Aeschylus here is that the law courts are important and can draw us out of this ancient history of blood feuds and into a place where the courts can adjudicate what is right at this sort of dispassionate distance. So lots of fun in there, great adaptation of this that appeals to modern listeners. I think you can find it on Audible. If you're interested at all, that's there for you. All right, the next idea is that a classical education is moral and humane. And the idea there is that it teaches us right from wrong and gets us to think about our own moral choices. A great example of that in our work with the kids was Our Town by Thornton Wilder. I know many of you have probably seen difficult high school productions of Our Town. It's done many places, but I do think it's one of the best plays written in English. And I'll explain a little bit about that in a moment. I'll give you what the quick overview here is that it follows the story of Emily, who's a young girl in Grover's Corners in 1900s New Hampshire, and it follows her through everyday life over 13 years, through everyday life, marriage and family, and then finally death. So it's kind of meta-theatrical in that sense, where we get to experience, again, a character speaking from beyond the grave, who's looking back on her life and wondering what she may or may not have done differently. And so I'll show you a few photos from our production of Our Town. Thank you. So you can see from this production, we started outside. We created a town to give people an entry into the play. There was music. We served dinner for folks outside. Then we went inside and followed the story. And then in the third act, we came outside under the stars and created our graveyard actually outside in that plot outside of Constitution Hall. And on a cold November night with the moon out, we experienced a graveyard like we might actually be in one. Do I have the quote here? There's a great quote that typifies this play that I wanted to share with you, that I think really typifies the moral questions that Thornton Wilder is bringing into our town. Because it starts out almost mundane. Emily gets married to her high school sweetheart, has a few children, dies in childbirth, something very typical in that day and time, and then is able to come back with the help of our Virgil-like character, the stage manager, and look back on her life, and she revisits her 12th birthday, which everyone in the graveyard urges her not to do, because they say it'll be painful to go back and see what you cannot change. And what Emily takes from that is she says, do any human beings ever realize life while they live it? Every minute. And I think that is really what Thornton Wilder is trying to get us to see in this play. It's not a particular creed or dogma that he's trying to teach morally here, but that I think this ethic of presence, that it's easy to be lulled into the grind of everyday life. And instead, could we be present to what's going on in the lives of those around us and offer ourselves to them in a life-giving way? There are missed opportunities in the play, bad moral choices. The alcoholic choir director, Simon Stimson, stands out as someone we never know exactly what's wrong with him. But Emily comes back with this sense of seeing all of it happening and knowing that perhaps she could have been done more to be present. I hear that message nowadays, COVID and 2020, there's so much going on. I think it's a great message for all time, this idea of being aware, slowing down and being aware of what's around us. So if you're into that notion of tuning up your vocabulary around virtue, I'd really recommend a book I read this year by a Greek scholar, Edith Hall, a British scholar, called Aristotle's Way. This is written for a popular audience, super accessible. Basically, she takes you through Aristotle's idea of eudaimonia, which is his idea of human flourishing, through his Nicomachean Ethics, and applies it to areas of human potential, communication, self-knowledge, intention, community, love, what we do with our leisure time, and ultimately mortality. Again, the audiobook on this one is excellent. So much to dig through there. You should add that to your book club if you have a book club. All right. The next idea that I wanted to talk about is that a classical idea is generative. I'll go light on this, but the idea is basically that if you have a really deep well of knowledge, and really great stories that were brought to you as a child, you cannot help but reflect on those for the rest of your life. And if you end up doing any kind of creative pursuit, they're gonna guide you. Those stories are gonna stick with you forever. They say a classic is something that everyone knows the name of, right? But it also gives birth to more classics. One example of that was our play Anonymous by Naomi Izuka in 2013. This takes the story of Homer's Odyssey and transfers it to a young man who's an immigrant in the United States and a sort of terrifying, wild, fantastical characters that he meets and interacts with in this world. So I'll show you a few. I can never get back to my audio here. Let me see. Sorry, guys. There we go.
Oh, 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 oh. I am a poor wayfaring stranger, traveling this world alone. There's no sickness, toil or danger in that bright land to which I go. I'm going there to see my mother. I'm going there no more to roam. But I'm only going over Jordan, I'm only going over home.
All right. Great rework of That Old Spiritual too by Jamie Woon. Yeah, the only thing I wanted to share here too in this idea of the generative nature of the classics is it doesn't happen on accident. It is a creative process. So some of the skills that we're teaching kids to take those stories and change them into new things, I do this in my playwriting class even, are based on our Brookfield Academy art standards. So I thought I'd just share those with you. First, we start with perceiving, the ability to see your and take in your sensory world and make something of it, to be able to interpret what you're taking in with your five senses and being able to see and hear and taste and smell more deeply. From that, we create. We give them skills that are necessary to make, design, play, paint, draw, sing in a four-part choral arrangement, to act. And then it's really critical that kids are able to take what they're learning and making and put it in context, that is to understand art, great art from the past, and be able to put what they're making sort of in that context. That's central to that idea of generativity. I don't know if that's a word. And then evaluating, being able to evaluate their work, other people's work, and receive evaluation back from them. That's critical. And then finally, connecting what they're making to other disciplines, right? Theater is a very interdisciplinary art, contains visual music, visual arts, music, and drama all within itself, but also to connect what they're learning to other careers, personal development, and skills as well. If you like the idea of taking an old myth and rediscovering it in a new form, I really would recommend Madeline Miller Searcy. She's a middle school teacher from out east who wrote this New York Times bestselling interpretation, again, of the Odyssey. This time she focuses on a small character that entraps Odysseus in the original story and turns his guys into pigs and sends them into the ocean. But this takes a really compassionate and interesting view of what it would be like to be a witch sorceress who was kicked out of your divine family and locked on an island for all eternity, and what she might have experienced that led her to be the character she is. Incidentally, my boys love this. I have three boys at home. We had read some illustrated versions of the Iliad and Odyssey over the summer. This is kind of a YA book, so it goes maybe a little further than the lower school idea, but certainly as an adult, you're going to love this story. Beautiful, beautiful writing in this. All right, my last point is that a classical education should be playful, and I think we get what that means. I'll just show you this example of Shakespeare in Love. I think it was quintessentially this idea of teaching kids a classic work of art, which is Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet, but the playwright Tom Stoppard, and then adapted by Lee Hall from Mark Norman's original script, imagines how Romeo and Juliet might have been written, how Shakespeare might have approached his own life that led him to write this play. So let's look at a few pictures of this. So if you got a chance to see Shakespeare in Love, of course it had all of those sword fights, comedy, the cross-dressing that drove the story along, but also was a reflection of something that happened in Elizabethan theater. And then that great, all that great text and poetry from Romeo and Juliet. I think it's a perfect example of how we can teach kids one thing and then send them out to play with it and bring their whole person to the experience. There was a little bit of early music there. And the last thing I wanted to share with you as an inspiration for your own life. If you're into, I'm not really into early music so much, but there, this group, this Austrian composer, she's a harpist and plays the theremin, which is this great, huge, gigantic lute from early music, gets together with musicians around the world and takes early music and mixes it with jazz interpretations and world music. So super, super captivating. This album titled Music for a While takes its title from Purcell, who was a composer, a sort of late contemporary of Shakespeare, and actually composed things for performances of Shakespeare and for Greek plays. This one comes from an aria from the Agamemnon or the Oresteia. And just achingly beautiful, amazing, life-giving music. If you're into this kind of thing, cue this one up on Spotify. Christina Pluar and the group is called La Paginata. All right, so that is the end of my spiel there. I hope I didn't go too long, Linda.
You are fine. That's great. Thank you. Do you want to open it up, see if there's some questions?
Yeah, I would love to put this out to you folks. A lot of you have experienced your kids being involved with the arts. Maybe some of you haven't. What do you think about these five aspects of classical education that I offered, and what are your thoughts?
I have a question.
Go ahead, Ken.
Hey, Ken.
I'll start off. I got a good one, Wes. I'm not trying to lock you down on anything here, so feel free to talk in circles if you want to, and pick out the component you want to talk about, but there are kind of two parts to this. There's been a tension for literally 2,000 years about how to teach things, and do we teach at least start with teaching and performing a standard canon of performances, even if they're not fun, but because the teachers think this is, you know, good for the students and good for society, or do we not have a standard canon? Because some people bristle at being told, here's, we're all going to run you through this filter, as opposed to them deciding more what to do. And second of all, in addition to the standard canon component, you talk about foundational, resting, moral, generative, and playful. What do we do if the standards of what for those evolve and change? I mean, for example, to use a practical example, to not be theoretical, I mean, Jeff King, your counterpart who runs a magnificent theater department at Shorewood, wanted to put on To Kill a Mockingbird, but it was deemed to be that he crossed over the line and the community stopped him from putting that show on a few years ago. So with all of that, canon versus not canon, and what if the standards change? How do you and how do we all deal with that?
That's a great question. So a couple parts there. Don't get me wrong. Some of what we teach is challenging and difficult. So I gave those examples from how to get into Shakespeare, the kind of seven steps that I take to show you that it's not just a walk in the park. But you mentioned, like, you know, do we teach a standard canon even if it's not fun? I would say no. I would urge that we really have to make it accessible to kids. Now, what that fun looks like, I don't think the hard work has to be not fun. I just think we need to be artful in how we approach it. I teach that process with Shakespeare every year to kids doing the National Shakespeare Competition. And I kind of trick them into it. So, I mean, I give them pieces. I don't make them choose out of the blue. Things like that are too hard. I try to pick things that I think fit their personality. And then we keep them short, right? They're really only learning less than 20 lines. But then I get them on their feet right away. And I don't linger too long on any one of those skills that I'm trying to teach. But these kids, now they're benefiting from a history of a Brookfield Academy of education, many of them. But they're able to pick it up and have fun with it right away. I think making it accessible right away is really important. Shakespeare didn't mean for his plays to be read off the page. Sorry, English teachers, you have a real challenge there if you're just going to read it. You need to, but our English teachers don't do that. They get them on their feet. They hand them swords. They have them speak out loud. That kind of stuff, I think, while it's not Xbox or, you know, Nintendo Switch, it's fun. And I think if we love the stories, they will love them. But I do think you need to make it, I'm not talking about frosting on the cake. I just think you need to show them the life in it right away. I don't know about whether the standards for classics change. They do. There's a lot that's problematic in Shakespeare. I don't hide that from my students. I mean, they're, you know, look at his talk about Jews. Often the casual language there is just plain anti-Semitic. I don't think we do our kids a favor by trying to hide those things or whitewash Shakespeare. They should just know that all of us could have racist opinions in that particular example. And it's important to know where they come from and try to move beyond them. I don't think we should throw the baby out with the bathwater, though, because if just because Shakespeare used racist turns of phrase in places or misogynistic things, I mean, Taming of the Shrew is a very complicated and sort of fraught play in how it deals with women. But I think if we can see all of the good that he's writing there as well, it's really important to take that whole view. So To Kill a Mockingbird, I hope we don't throw it out. We got to be able to put it in context. So that's one of our art standards right there.
Thank you. Any other questions? Wes, I was wondering, you know, for people who maybe their children have never gotten into the arts much, maybe they're all about science or sports or whatever, and they really haven't dipped their toe into the arts world yet. How would you encourage them to get involved?
Right. Well, we do have an arts requirement at the school, and I would say try to choose something you think they might like or might try on. And this is my pitch for Brookfield Academy. One of the awesomest things about here is we have athletes who come in and are amazing visual artists. Some of my favorite actors are athletes because they know how to think in a whole body way. So I'd say encourage them, give them a chance. But also I would challenge you, and I think that's maybe a little bit why I gave you guys a book list, gave you homework, because I think you have to love this stuff. If you, you know, sometimes Friday night we can be tired and we don't want to go out and see a play. But if you go anyways, take the effort and bring your children along, and they'll grumble, but take them to dinner beforehand and buy them dessert, and try to pick something you think they'll like. They will start to love it as well, but you have to love it for them to love it. And then, you know, bring them to Brookfield Academy, because we have so many awesome, awesome opportunities here in visual arts, music, and theater.
Absolutely. Thanks, Wes.
Yep.
All right. We're almost at an hour, but we could still fit in another question if anyone has one for us today. Anybody else? All right. Oh, Todd?
Todd, are you going
to? Oh, I just wanted to say how much I appreciated all the structure, Wes, that you put into what you covered and the audio and the visual. That was really helpful for me. I've studied Greek and Latin. And so a lot of this is fairly familiar to me. I've studied Aristotle as well. And I think I really liked your framework. So I'm looking forward to getting the document, we don't already have it, that you just went through, including the reading list. I thought it was a really helpful framework, and I'd like to talk more about it.
Awesome. I'd love to have dinner and have a glass of wine with all of you guys and continue this conversation in that vein. Yeah, thanks, Dodd. The file size will be huge because it has photos in it, but I'll find a way to compress it a bit and get it to Linda, and then maybe, Linda, you and I could get the reading list kind of like put together so people
Absolutely.
Could, just in an email, maybe even with Amazon links or whatever, so people could easily access it.
That's what I was going to ask for. I tried to take notes on your book list and your audio, suggestions, and as far as spelling goes, and some of the stuff you were saying, I'm like, I was way too slow.
Okay, great.
So just a list of, something for us to follow up. A lot of that just, was just fascinating, and wanted to dig deeper into it and just, get a greater understanding and perspective of where you're coming from. I wasn't able to take the notes fast enough. But thank you very much for your time, Wes. It was a great presentation.
Well, thanks for being here.
We will definitely get everything out to you. I want to say his reference to this book, The Aristotle's Way. I love this book. I've tagged it up so many places just going through it. And now you are inspiring me to read it again. So maybe we will get a book club going.
I would love to.
While you're talking, that actually is in even a PDF form that you can pull up for free, apparently.
Oh, really? Great. All right. Wes, thank you very much.
Thank you, Linda. This has been really fun.
Good. And we're all clapping for you.
Yeah, that was wonderful. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. And I'm glad you enjoyed seeing the photos. It was cool to see your students' work and all the amazing things they've done. So thanks for, supporting what we do here.
All right. And everyone, this is recorded, so it will be out and available to others soon. All right. Take care.
Thanks, Linda. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.